According to the guidebooks, one of the best ways of appreciating Glastonbury is to arrive there by train. From the vantage point of a railway carriage, one can begin to digest everything that's on offer. Glastonbury Station, which lies some little distance west of the town, is on the Somerset and Dorset Joint Railway, which has worked in conjunction with the Midland and London and South West Railways. The railway is considered to be of great importance to Glastonbury, and since its opening the number of inhabitants has become greater, and trade has increased. The service of trains is very good to and from the Midlands via Bath, and there are excellent connections to and from Weymouth, Bournemouth, Poole, Swanage and Exeter. The main line of the Great Western Railway is joined at Highbridge, whilst the best route from London is with the London and South West Railway from Waterloo, changing at Templecombe and proceeding with the Somerset and Dorset Joint Railway via Evercreech. But of course the main problem with these particular guidebooks is that they're all a bit out of date, and in fact the railway connection to Glastonbury ceased to exist back in 1966 when the line was closed down, and it's never seen a single train since. The overhead canopy that used to shelter the station platforms was unceremoniously transplanted to the centre of town, where it now stands in a car park. On the horizon, the distinctive landmark of Glastonbury Tor. Once an island in swampy lowlands flooded out by the Bristol Channel, it's been a place of magic, legend and superstition down through the ages. There's even supposed to be a secret entrance to the underworld. The word Tor is a West Country word of Celtic origin that simply means a hill. Glastonbury Tor is a natural formation of layers of clay and blue limestone capped by a mass of hard sandstone. Prehistoric remains found in the land immediately surrounding it suggest an early settlement going back 5,000 years. On top of the tor, the tower is all that remains of a medieval chapel which was built to replace an earlier church that had been destroyed in an earthquake in the 13th century. There are good views to be had all round. From the spiritual powerhouse of Glastonbury, one can see right out across a patchwork quilt of England's green and pleasant land to a silhouette of the nuclear powerhouse at Hinkley Point. Whilst the tour has provided the backdrop to ancient and holy legends since time immemorial, it was also the scene of the hanging of the last abbot of Glastonbury during the violent days of the Reformation. What is it that's so special about Glastonbury?
The history of this land goes back thousands of years, and before the Christians were here, and that's 2,000 years ago, the Druids were here, the Celts were here.
Basically, it is that people need a focal point. London is said sometimes to be the mind and the financial centre of Britain, and Glastonbury its heart. And I think that that is true because of the role it's played historically as a main centre.
Glastonbury, I believe, is one of the most holy and sacred places in the world. One of the most mystical.
Well, I found a place where I could just be myself and not be somebody that I wasn't.
Spiritually, it is very much at the heart of life in this country, partly because it has the possibility of bringing people together at the level of folk religion and paganism, and honouring all that is good in that tradition, and hopefully holding fast to the Christian revelation, which is absolutely crucial for the well-being of the life of the country.
As far as I understand, the Church of England refers to Glastonbury as the holiest land in Britain, and I believe this stems from the tradition of Joseph of Arimathea coming to Glastonbury with Jesus as a child.
There are many legends about Glastonbury. One of the most popular ones is that Jesus's uncle, Joseph of Arimathea, arrived on a hill near the Tor and dug his wooden staff into the earth, which promptly took root, sprouted and flowered, and became a unique thorn tree which has blossomed ever after on Christmas Day. In the Middle Ages, somebody tried to chop it down, but the axe sprang back and a wood chip flew into his eye, which partially blinded him. But because such records are so full of superstition, it's almost impossible to sort out what's true and what's false.
Well, there are a lot of legends, and there's an attempt made to clarify the situation. One of the legends put out was that Joseph Arimathea came to Glastonbury in AD 37, within a few years of the resurrection. But Welsh scholars have tended to indicate that Joseph Arimathea didn't come here until about AD 63. Now, there is quite a substantial difference between the two. When you have that, you come up against the matter of probabilities rather than certainties. But then the scholars can argue, and the ordinary people can have their own views. And in the end, you come up against the question of what is truth? A rumour on Monday becomes a legend on Wednesday, and it becomes history by Friday.
A similar question mark hangs over the claim that King Arthur and his wife Guinevere lie buried at Glastonbury Abbey. Although the story's been around for centuries, it may well have been started as little more than a publicity stunt. But the Abbey's unique claim to supreme antiquity comes from the belief that a hut built by Joseph of Arimathea stood on the site originally. Whatever the truth about that, successive Anglo-Saxon kings enriched the place, and Glastonbury proved to be the only religious house of any significance that survived the Danish invasion of the 9th century. An abbot by the name of Dunstan turned it into the driving force of a fervent monastic revival, but a couple of centuries later, most of the buildings and manuscripts were destroyed when the abbey caught fire. Rebuilding began, and by its final completion in the 16th century, it boasted the largest church in England, but was becoming more and more like a hotel which provided package deals of entertainment, including actors, musicians and comedians for which visitors were expected to pay, a sort of medieval Butlins. When King Henry VIII appointed himself head of the Church of England, the Abbot of Glastonbury was charged with stealing, and as a result was hung on the Tor with two of his monks. His head was then cut off and displayed above the abbey gate, whilst the rest of his body was hacked into four pieces for public exhibition in neighbouring towns, so as to put the fear of the king into as many hearts as possible. Local gangs ripped all the lead off the abbey roof and melted it down on bonfires made from the ornately carved woodwork. The stained glass windows were smashed in and stone pillars were auctioned off, broken down and used for building local highways. The abbey changed hands several times and became regarded as a white elephant. Some further wheeling and dealing in the early 20th century landed it back into the hands of the Church of England, who then took it upon themselves to preserve the relics as one of the most precious historical monuments. And it's been a tourist attraction ever since. As one local vicar put it, holding the services al fresco makes it easier to reach God because at least there's no roof to penetrate. Having played out its role as a focal point of Christianity in England throughout history, today's Glastonbury has become a melting pot for all kinds of alternative beliefs.
I think what's generally recognised as that is a lot of what I call the psychobabble that goes on around here, which is to do with the astral plane, the illusory side of things, the Maya. Mediums, clairvoyance, channeling, all of that comes under the category of New Ageism. There are people that worship the goddess, believe it's the earth, you know, and then there are those caught in the rigidity of structures of religions and churches. It's so prevalent here, this god versus goddess thing. But that's what Glastonbury is about, you know. Across the board, I think every kind of weird that there is here, really. Wizards and witches, there's certainly plenty of those, and some days it seems every second person you meet is a reincarnated Merlin or an Arthur, a Guinevere. People come here with all their illusions and delusions and and manifest those. There's the dark and the light here, very much so. But the age of mysticism is to go. You know, we're coming into an age of enlightenment of Aquarius, and mysticism, we have to come through the mists, the fogs, if you like, and that's what a lot of people experience here, is the fogs, the mists of illusion, and we have to cut through those and come up onto a higher plane and see that things as they really are and work for the betterment of everyone.
Attempts to cash in on the sacred energies of Glastonbury have resulted in the town having more than its fair share of specialised alternative shops. It's great if you're out looking for a book on do-it-yourself witchcraft, or a new Ouija board and some psychedelic footwear, but if you're just out shopping for something ordinary like a pair of pillowcases, you'd best go and look elsewhere. Crystals, lucky charms, aromatic oils and miscellaneous New Age knick-knacks, punctuated with tarot, psychic and rune readings, provide a certain appeal to visitors on the lookout for something that's a bit different. How did this alternative tendency come about?
I would reckon that it was going on round the turn of this century, and that was the time when relationship between the Anglican Church and the Roman Catholic Church were pretty diabolical. Well, now, a lot of people faced with that sort of religious conflict are going to start looking for something which is a bit different. You began to get the sort of situation in which a division grew up between those who were accepting the conventional spirituality of the church in those days and those who were beginning to turn to spiritualism. And one of the things that that gave rise to is modern interest in the signs of the zodiac, for example, and also the science which goes with it. Now, that is a tremendous challenge to the whole way in which we've been thinking in this country for the last 150 years, in which natural science and religion have been daggers drawn.
Well, there's a bit of a demand for it. I personally get a bit fed up with all the crystals and the tarot cards and stuff like that in just about every shop. But there is a demand for it. The tourists that come in, they want that, so that's why. Because we have to cater for the people that live here and the tourists that come in, because that's how Glastonbury makes its money. I'm an incense blender. Well, I blend incenses, which are loose incenses that you put onto charcoal. I try and use organic ingredients where possible, and ingredients that I've picked from the hedgerows and picked out of my garden. I also have to purchase some things like, for example, sandalwood and myrrh and frankincense and gums like that, which can't be grown in this country. And I dream in smells, and I get the smells from my incenses in my dreams. It's quite wacky, really.
Glastonbury caters for people of all tastes. Its international fame has earned it a mark on the map for anyone taking a break in the West Country, and there's a regular turnover of visitors. Energy meridians of the Earth, known as ley lines, are said to pass through the town, although such gems of educational wisdom are sometimes lost on those more interested in their picnic lunch. To complement the physical food, there's any amount of spiritual nourishment. Glastonbury is a magnet for people who are on some kind of a search, and apart from lying back on a bed of nails and trying to penetrate your innermost being, there are numerous healing centres and retreats to choose from, as well as study courses offering deep philosophical insight, self-realisation, and pathways to enlightenment of one sort or another. People from all over the world feel drawn by the special energies of the place.
In speaking with other people and listening to other people's comments, visitors from abroad, many people say coming to Glastonbury is coming home. It's like coming home. And the fact that people are offering healing right now is just a modern expression of something which happens naturally. The work that I do reflects the ancient wisdom, which is a universal wisdom, the wisdom that was available to mankind before we became too intellectual or too materialistic. So it's a wisdom of the self. I think the New Age, as I understand it, is finding that which is eternal in us and experiencing that in a new way.
Perhaps the best-known healing centre in Glastonbury is the Chalice Well. During the 18th century, it was proclaimed that drinking its water was a cure for asthma, and the rumour spread throughout the whole of England. 10,000 visitors descended on the place, but doctors who analysed the water dismissed its curative powers, and the excitement soon died down. Nevertheless, the water continues to be taken by locals and tourists alike. If you visit there today, the first thing you'll find is that it's run by yet another American.
When people get to know us, we get past the first impression of the shock of American being in a British site. I mean, I don't know how I would feel if I went to America, went to one of my sacred sites, and found a British person running that. I'd be like, well, couldn't you find your own people to run that? You know, I understand that. So we're always prepared for that first instance, and then it fades away because the garden speaks for itself. There's no way of knowing where this amount of water is coming from. It's 25,000 gallons per day. They say it's in the Mendips, they say it's various places, but they can't actually locate its source. We feel that the reason why this is also drawn through so much mystery is its age. When we've had excavations here, they found Neolithic remains. I mean, this place has been visited for a very long time, and the water's been here for a very long time. So it would hold its own mystique. Well, they say that Joseph Arimathea came with the boy Jesus when he was young. And later on, Joseph came back with the Grail, the cruet that held the blood of Christ after Christ was crucified. He brought it back to Glastonbury, and he buried that cruet here at Chalice Well, which is why the water runs red today. Yes. It's iron-based, so when the air hits it, it's going to turn red. The water does have healing properties. I've seen it. And I've seen it in simple cases where people come in with sprained ankles from the tour and put their foot in the water. Now, medically speaking, cold water will eliminate a swell. So someone may generally say, well, you know, it's cold water. But not to the extent that I've seen. But more importantly, the one that really turned my mind was a gentleman came in with oil burns on his body. Now, oil burns are serious burns. And the only thing he had used was Chalice Well water. And when he went to the hospital, the day that he had these burns, and he came in and he wasn't screaming in pain, they said, well, you know, what are you taking? He said, well, I'm not taking anything. And they were shocked. They said, what'd you do? And he said, well, we took the water of Glastonbury. We've been using that. It must have been about 3 weeks later when we saw him the next time. Everything was healed on his arm. Impossible. Impossible. And the pink that was left on his neck was healing. It's amazing. This kind of place is few and far between. The energy is here. You can't take it from the land, and people need to experience it on the land. But when you leave from here, you do take it with you. So when someone comes in and is and then goes off to America, goes off to Australia and Germany and Switzerland and Africa, wherever we see people, they take it back with them. So in a way, we're creating little Chalice Wells all over the world by the people themselves.
In an England still nominally regarded as a Christian country, the Glastonbury Pilgrimage Weekend provides a well-organised outward expression of the faith. The Church of England invades the High Street on the Saturday, and the Catholics follow suit on the Sunday. Everybody gets into the spirit of things as the event gathers momentum. So how did the tradition come about?
Well, if you go back to the days of what people call the undivided church of the Middle Ages, it wasn't really undivided because you had the struggle for power between the crown and the papacy, in which Glastonbury was very much a flashpoint. And that conflict has never really been resolved. If you have a desire to have a focal point which is of national significance, which Glastonbury has been right through the ages, one of the things that would happen would be that you would have it as a centre of pilgrimage.
Please keep coming up this way. Form up in logical order. No problem.
And now it's got to the stage where a movement which began uniting and providing for a measure of spiritual impetus for the Anglo-Catholic movement in the Church of England has become more divided. There are all sorts of deep historical reasons which lie behind this, and in particular there is the question of how the Church of England relates to the Roman Catholic Church.
Such display of ecclesiastical pageantry is faithfully attended year by year by the thousands of pilgrims who pour into the abbey and town. Whether by accident or design, the weekend sometimes coincides with the Glastonbury Pop Festival. The combination guarantees that a shared sense of euphoria is experienced by one and all.
Talk about unity, but it doesn't really mean very much, because all that people outside the church see is division. And until that situation is changed, we're not going to get very much further forward.
The Georgian Pilgrim Hotel dates from the 15th century and was built as an overspill for travellers visiting the abbey. Many a person has dropped in here for a bishop's tipple or a Benedictine chaser. There's rumour of a connecting passage to the abbey, but that was all bricked up a long time ago. One of the hotel's attractions is the supposed presence of a friendly ghost who puts in an appearance on odd occasions in one of the bedrooms. Some of the guests who stay here claim to have seen it, others have heard the occasional bump in the night, and then there are those who dismiss the whole thing as a lot of nonsense. The words of William Blake's poem, "And Did Those Feet in Ancient Times," refer to what is arguably the most far-fetched of Glastonbury legends, that Jesus Christ visited Glastonbury in his youth. The story appears to have been based upon an early historical manuscript which described the original church in Glastonbury as not having been built by man, but having been prepared by God himself. Taken literally, it was interpreted as meaning that the incarnate God visited Britain and built the church before starting his public ministry, a notion which got handed down from one generation to the next. Nevertheless, the sentiment was well-intentioned. Glastonbury is England's only real national shrine, and however unlikely a Glastonbury legend may be, it still makes a jolly good song.